boxes, they put planter boxes in, I think, on Jones Street, down, up and down, but the problem was people were using them for purposes for which they were not intended. That was one. So you have to kind of coordinate with the police to ask them how what happened. And another thing with planter boxes is sometimes you have to make sure they're watered and pruned or whatever they have to do. You can't just plant stuff and then walk away.
It's a perfectly real life example of where experience and knowledge can be shared with the project designers so that they don't just do something without taking that input. It's a very valid point, especially in the neighborhood.
On this street in Taylor, there's very, very few accidents occurring, and therefore I don't see it necessary to be even different down here. Many cars come to the corner and rest at the stop when they're changed. There's nothing to do to get hit by cars that I have seen. I've been here quite a long time.
The gentleman is not so much a question, but just a comment that he's been observing Eddie and Taylor for quite a long time, and he doesn't feel that he sees many vehicle accidents right here at Eddie and Taylor, correct, sir?
Every blue moon, there might be one. But, and I'm just thinking that all the money that the city's planning to put into this project is just another way of loose spending. And I look, I just ask him a question along with a lot of times that, who said to me, think about all this stuff? I mean, I could see it was actually a problem. You're doing, records or daily basis or...
Sure.
But you don't never see that. So what's all this waste for? I mean, there's so many things that can be done with that money to benefit people who don't have homes and all the rest.
Sorry, I mean...
No, you do what you mean. Let me finish. Thank you. So...
But, I mean...
I know, but...
It's a long agenda that I want to keep to
no, excuse
issue.
Me. If you cut nobody off, please stop.
And it doesn't have anything
stop
to do with
it.
This project.
Excuse me, it does.
Or
sure does. It does. I talked to him. I'm not talking to you. So please don't do that to me. You did that to no one else. Thank you.
That's
be respectful
point.
Of my...
Be
respectful
question?
Of me to... Anyone who's listening can hear. Whisper in your ears.
Yes, and this is on video.
Done.
I just want to get to the question.
All right. Okay, we need to move on. The presenter yeah. will stay at the end of the meeting and you can talk to him afterwards.
Right.
We still have more questions. And he did pass out these questionnaires. So could you return them to him? And then we've got to move on to the next.
Thank you again very much for your time.
You.
And thanks to the board.
The next
for,
one
for,
on the thank you for your patience.
I mean, you
and,
gave a comment. You gave a comment.
We have to move on with the agenda.
That wasn't
yeah.
right.
Are we going to order?
This, yeah, the next one's the second.
That wasn't
yeah.
right.
So then, so yeah, the next one will list is the 10 of all the things.
Hi.
Thank you.
I'm Valerie Rose, and I'm here on behalf of the St. Francis Memorial Hospital Foundation. I have my colleagues with me here today, Paul Tarkin and Jan Hahn, and Terry. Terry's going to be passing out a clipboard for a sign-in sheet. I know you signed in for your meeting. We ask you to just give us your name and email and telephone number, especially if you want us to follow up with you afterwards. And she's also handing out a brochure that describes our initiative and a comment card, similar to the piece of paper that you have from Fernando. We'd like your comments as well. So,
hello, you guys are waiting. I'm Paul Harkin from the Glide Foundation. I just want to say I've worked in the Tenderloin for 17 years, working with homeless people, with drug users, people with mental health issues. And when I first came to San Francisco, I noticed how many people on the streets were in situations where they were using drugs. And I'm shocked because I didn't live here, just at the sheer volume. And in the 17 years since, it seems like there's even more of that which is happening. So what this presentation is about is offering a solution to the problem, you know, of folks publicly injecting. It's a humane, compassionate solution. It's looking at giving people a facility where they're medically supervised. And there's many of these in the world that exist already. So just, I'm asking folks, as somebody who's worked in the TL for 17 years, to keep an open mind and let us finish the presentation, and then we'll answer questions.
Thanks. Okay, thanks for that, Paul. So we are a group of people that have been working on this issue, have been talking about this issue for close to 3 years. And we are talking about it because, as you know, every day in the newspaper, every day you turn on your television, every day you talk to somebody and you hear about the opioid epidemic. It's a public health crisis, not just in Ohio or West Virginia, but right here in San Francisco and in the Tenderloin. And so that's why we're here, because we have a solution that we think can help mitigate that problem, especially here in the Tenderloin. What are some of the effects of this crisis? You've seen it probably. Let me ask you, by a show of hands only, how many of you have seen anyone here injecting drugs or perhaps having an overdose, or you've helped someone with an overdose? So quite a few of you. And so there is a big issue and a big problem that we want to solve in a public health way, because it's a health issue. It's not a law enforcement issue only. It is a health issue. So the issue has to do with public injecting of drugs, with improperly discarded needles in the streets and the sidewalks and those planter boxes we talked about earlier, and fatal and non-fatal overdoses, of which there are hundreds. And Paul's going to talk about that later when we are finished. So our group has been, as I said, talking about this for close to 3 years. You can see that we have a very diverse participation in our group. We've got education, we've got faith communities, we've got philanthropy, we've got Urban Survivors Union, the Drug User Union, we have the mayor's office, and we have your own Captain Ewing on our group, who attends or has attended many of our meetings, and we've done presentations at her community meetings as well. So we have pretty much a multi-sector collaboration of people talking about this issue from the lens of public health and of a crisis. There are other initiatives, you may have heard of them. Have you heard of the BREED Task Force, any of you, that is meeting to, through the Department of Public Health, that is also meeting to talk about this issue? Anyone? Okay, a couple people have, so great. That's good. So they're talking about it, we're talking about it. There's another coalition that is doing broad-based campaign awareness and getting people mobilized, people, including people who inject drugs, people who are public health professionals or medical professionals or nonprofit organizations, getting people organized and mobilized to do something about it. We're going to talk about what we want to do about it when we get into the presentation. There's also an assembly bill in the California legislature right now, which just passed two committees and the entire assembly. So now it goes to the Senate, and this is good, this is approved. And what this would mean is at the state level, any public health department could run or could sponsor a safe injection facility, a safe injection site, a safe drug consumption site. Those words are kind of used interchangeably, so forgive me if I say more than one set of words. And this bill would allow it to happen anywhere in the state, and anybody that did it would be held harmless, so they would be covered legally under any kind of legal prohibitions that currently exist. So I didn't even tell you what we're proposing. Paul said it, so we're going to be proposing safe drug consumption space or spaces. We're going to talk about two different kinds of models that we've been evaluating and assessing the cost thereof. And we think that this is a better way for people who inject drugs to do it. So they're not doing it on the street. They're not putting themselves at risk for more health issues. They're not exposing people to it. They're not exposing your kids, your businesses, your families, your colleagues, anyone, and especially themselves. They're not exposing themselves to danger. And so we're proposing a safe and legitimate place, a non-judgmental place where people can go and inject drugs should they be doing that. So this is our goal of our organization. And like Fernando, we're engaged in a community engagement process as well. So we want your feedback. We want your input. We want your comments. And we want to know if you will support this initiative when the time comes. And that timeline is probably this September for the citywide London Breed Task Force. There will be recommendations made to the Board of Supervisors and to the mayor. And so we want to be ready. If the mayor says, yes, do it, then we want the Tenderloin to be ready. Why the Tenderloin? Because the Tenderloin is the intersection of homelessness and vulnerable populations and people who inject drugs. And it's very visible here. Would you agree it's a very visible kind of issue that happens? And most of what we're talking about, the data that we have to support this initiative, comes from Vancouver. And why is that? Because the east side of Vancouver is almost just like the Tenderloin. And so we believe that we can use their data, their information, and their evaluation of over 10 years of data to support this cause. So this is our solution, a place where people can go. It's indoor, it's safe, it's clean, it's hygienic, it's private. Clean syringes are provided. A person can walk into that space or that organization with no syringes, go in, get a clean syringe, and leave that syringe there once it's used. Not going to be disposed in the street. We're using the Vancouver model because it's clinically supervised, so it's got nurses or nurse practitioners or people in the medical field who can watch over someone so they don't overdose. Paul mentioned there are 100 of these sites throughout the world, 100 sites, and there has been zero fatal overdoses. Yes, there have been overdoses, but because they're monitored by medical professionals, they're not dying as a result of the injection. And these sites also have ground rules, like you have on the back of your agenda. They have rules of conduct, and they're also staffed by peers. People like Jen would be working there. People like Jen work in the site in Vancouver. So people who are have familiarity with injection drug use are either currently injecting drugs or are in recovery, so-called recovery. And the main reason that we're proposing these sites is because they provide ready access to treatment options. So imagine that. You walk into a site, and if you're ready that day to get into detox or get into treatment, people there can help you or help a person do that. This is what they look like. If you can see this in the back or on the sides, you see that it's very brightly lit, it's clean, it's sterile, it's private. So a person can come in there, inject their drug, be watched, be monitored for any kind of side effects. And then they, most of these sites have what's called a chill room, so a person can go there and just kind of chill out, hang out for a while, and leave when they need to leave or when they want to leave. They're not forced to do that. They're just offered that option to do that. So we would propose the same kind of site, or a similar kind of site that Vancouver has. This is just a picture of supplies. You see that the red box, the needle disposal box, the needles stay there. They don't go back into the streets. So what is it not? We told you what it is and what it looks like, but it's not a place where a person can go and get drugs. It's not a place where a person can go and share drugs, because we know the reason that we don't have more HIV infections is because we have needle exchange. Jen works at a needle exchange, and Terry works at a needle exchange. So there's no sharing of syringes, so that message is going to get through even more than it already has since the late 80s. No sharing of syringes, no sharing of drugs, and no selling of drugs. And the benefits to people and the community, and we see people who inject drugs as part of the community, not a separate community, we're all one community, there's less HIV and hepatitis C transmission. How many of you saw the news probably within the last month, hepatitis C's exponential rise, like 800%, right? So, and it's very costly. I'll get to your question at the end. It's very costly, and I'm going to show you that on another slide. So the other benefits are, is it bug here, or is it closer, is that there's less syringe sharing. Again, stopping those HIV and hepatitis C transmission infections, less public injecting, and less discarded syringes. It's more safe, it's more hygienic. There's more possibilities to access services for people who have not been hooked into services at that time. And again, no fatal overdoses. So we're going to talk about two different kinds. A centralized site, which might be a new or renovated building, and decentralized sites where an organization, an existing organization, here in the Tenant Learner throughout the city, depending on what the mayor approves, would just expand their harm reduction services to offer safe injection. Because as Paul will tell you, people are already doing it in bathrooms in your nonprofit organization. I see a shaking of head, so when we get to you, when we get to questions, I want to hear what that shaking of head is about. So centralized would be, this is what it would look like. This is what it looks like in Vancouver. This is what we propose it would look like here. Security outside, kind of pushing away, you know, the bad drug dealers. Watching for issues and things that might be happening that aren't safe for the people inside and the people in the community. A reception and a waiting area. Materials, and like I said, a second space for people to chill out. So a decentralized model would be, let's just pretend, Glide, St. Anthony, Hospitality House. I heard Hospitality House was in the house tonight. And so maybe they would decide to expand their services to the population they already serve and just allow them in a safe and hygienic way to inject drugs under their premises. So the same features are in a centralized or decentralized, always security, always a waiting room, always clean syringes, always needle boxes. So a study was done in San Francisco by a local organization, and it was just looking at the cost of HIV and hepatitis C. So it wasn't looking at the cost of ambulances being called and EMTs and paramedics and the fire department. It was looking at averting HIV and hepatitis C costs. And you see the cost, very expensive to treat lifetime hepatitis C and HIV. So their study showed that San Francisco, if opened just one site, could save $3.5 million a year. We think it probably would be more than that, but this is what their study showed in terms of averting HIV and hepatitis C infections and the things that happen as a result of those things. We think a decentralized site where, I'm just gonna say it again, Glide Hospitality House, St. Anthony San Francisco AIDS Foundation opened a site, might cost maybe $500,000 or even less. A centralized site, if a new building needs to be renovated and outfitted and all of that stuff, would probably cost a little bit over $1 million a year. So why is this still a benefit to the community? Because there is less taxpayer dollars spent on emergency visits, on hospital costs, police and fire, and a decrease in the loss of business revenue. I heard some talk about that in an earlier presentation about businesses. Businesses are very concerned about losing revenues, and this is one way to help defer those costs. So we ask you, what you can do is talk about this idea with your friends, your family, your colleagues, whoever you interact with on a daily basis. Say, what do you think about having a safe drug consumption site in the Tenderloin? Just see what people think. We've been doing these presentations for the past month and a half, and we've heard comments, and we've heard concerns, and we've also heard a lot of support. We understand if there isn't support, we need to hear that and know what that is so that we can address that. Michael came to one of our presentations and he requested a presentation for your group. So we ask if you want a presentation for your group, put that on the comment card. Make sure you give us contact information so that we can follow up with that request. And let us know at some point in the future if you'll support this initiative. So in summary, it's good for the community as a whole, all of you, all of us. These kinds of services save money and save lives. They can be located in existing facilities or in new facilities. So if you do think you want a presentation, this is my contact information and Terry's contact information and Paul's contact information. And right now I'm going to open it up to questions, and Paul and Jen are going to handle that. I'll jump in if needed. We'll get to him first and then the gentleman in the back. And so please fire your questions away to these two individuals. Thank you very much.
So
you mentioned
this gentleman.
Okay. I'm a rehab addict. So I'd say safe injection probably would have kept me from getting Hep C 24 years ago. So that's one thing. Two, when I was part of the AIDS Vigil at UN Plaza, back in the 80s, we talked about safe places to eject then. So I've been working on this for years. A friend of mine just told me right out here,